inverse function theorem for CK functions. Consider a function H that maps Qn to Rn bar, and the function H is a CK mapping, and Qn is an open subset of Rn. If H is invertible, namely, if the rank of the Jacobian J of H on X at X equals XP, if the rank of this Jacobian is equal to N, for all XP and Qn, then H inverse exists and is continuous and differentiable on the range of H of Qn to Qn bar in Rn bar. This statement about the rank of the Jacobian, the rank of the matrix means that if the columns of the matrix consist of linearly independent column vectors, the rank of the square matrix is equal to n, the number of columns. And this is equivalent to saying that the determinant of J is non-zero in this region. If such an inverse function exists and has these properties, then the new coordinates you get from the old ones, good coordinates of the manifold. So this theorem is useful for constructing and testing new coordinate systems. So let's give a few examples of this. In column vector notation for the differentials, these dxi's and dyk's are columns of differentials. Then you can write this Jacobian matrix as dhk by dxi. Converting this into a matrix multiplication, now we have this a little bit funny notation. Our matrix has an upstairs index and a downstairs index. Interpret that a little bit. The index upstairs is the row index of the matrix, and the downstairs is the column index. So in standard matrix notation, where you have HKI, the rows come first and then the columns. So row K and column I. So if you wanted to write this out for a 2x2 system, it would look like this. Dx column vector multiplied by the matrix H gives you the dy column vector over here. And notice the upstairs index is 1, 1. The first row has equal upstairs indices. And the columns, 1, column 2. Downstairs index gives you the columns. To change standard matrix notation to the upstairs, downstairs index notation, you take H of ki, rows and columns, and you levitate the index k upstairs. And so this allows you to do the Einstein summation on these indices. And if you wanted to think of H as a tensor, then H is going to be a mixed tensor, one contravariate index and one covariate index. And there's a notation that shows up a lot in the literature where we have our new variables yk equals hk of the x's. Sometimes this is simply written in shortened form as yk of xi, so y of x functions. When I was first studying this, I found this kind of confusing when you started seeing the y's and the formulas, and after a while it was kind of easy to forget which one was the dependent variable and which one was the new variable. And you will see this in the literature, especially in some of the older books and papers. So the Jacobian matrix, this HKI, is sometimes written just dyk by dxi, the derivative of the new coordinates y with respect to the old ones. Okay. When you have this type of notation, the variables on the bottom are independent, and the quantities up on top are the functions of the stuff on the bottom. So now look at this, the inverse matrix H bar Well, the inverse matrix is going to have x as the new coordinates. X's are equal to the inverse function h operating on the y's. So the Jacobian for the inverse transformation is written this way, dxk by dyi, and the xk's are given by the function h inverse. In simple cases, you know, 2, 3, 4 dimensions, you can push through these calculations and use Cramer's rule or Gaussian elimination to explicitly calculate the inverse transformation matrix H bar. Okay, I think I have some more notes here that are more for experts on manifolds. See, one of the properties of manifolds besides their coordinate systems is that manifolds have a topology associated with them. And we have used that topology for the local neighborhoods, you know, getting open sets and neighborhoods of points in M. The coordinate transformation actually carries along the topology between the points in Rn and the points in the original manifold. So when you do that, it's called a diffeomorphism. If you have smooth manifolds and you want H to be a diffeomorphism and preserve the topology of the manifold, then H is required to be C infinity differentiable. And this guarantees that the image of the manifold on Rn is topologically equivalent to the original topology of Mn for smooth manifolds. Now, another feature of this, you know, we've talked about these manifolds locally, but manifolds can have a global topology. You know, you can imagine in the large scale, have a sphere or maybe a torus or a Klein bottle. So, you know, all of those locally look like little linear spaces, little epsilon neighborhoods around points in small regions of the manifold. But in a global sense, they are quite different, and they have this large-scale topology, let's call it, which is also carried over and shows up in the coordinate transformation functions. So if you transform to a new set of coordinates from an old one, you want to make sure you don't leave behind some of the topology. And so to make sure that happens, you need to establish this diffeomorphism between the old coordinates of the manifold and the new one. A little diagram that kind of shows how these functions work together to provide this diffeomorphism on the manifold M. So we start out with M and its coordinates, and we have this coordinate generating function f that maps points in M to coordinates in Rn. F is invertible. So this has established our set of coordinates xi, and this f function is carrying whatever topology we may have imposed. You know, we can define topologies on M also by setting up coordinate systems that manifest those topologies, and so the inverse function f inverse carries those over to Mn. You can establish a topology on the manifold M by using the coordinates to put it there, roughly speaking. So if we have a new set of coordinates, they're going to be existing in a second instance of Rn bar. So yk are points in Rn bar, and they're obtained by h and map back to x with h inverse. Now this original function here can be used to establish a direct correspondence between the new coordinates and m by composing h inverse with F inverse. So if you compose H inverse, you're going to go up here, and then F inverse takes you back here. So that's equivalent to this shortcut here, mapping Rn bar back to the manifold Mn. So the inverse function theorem is used to find admissible coordinate transformation and also to find charts and establish an atlas on a manifold. Okay, so I think that's about all we wanted to talk about tonight, and I hope you enjoyed it. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.